ProPublica managed to get their hands on some incredibly disturbing audio of what happens at the border during one of these family separations that have been in the news so much recently. So let's listen, and then we'll come back and discuss.
Bueno, aquí tenemos una orquesta. ¿De dónde son ustedes?
Soy de Salvador.
¿Y tú?
Guatemala.
No llores. Vas a llegar con... Mira, ella te va a explicar y te va a ayudar. ¿Cierto, consulado?
¿Qué va a pasar con su consulado hoy?
El papá. Papá.
Yo
también. Con mi tía, por lo menos, porque después llegué.
So, I don't, when I hear that, I think there's, even for massive Trump supporters, and even for Republicans who are hardcore on the issue of immigration, doesn't that disturb you a little bit? Doesn't that upset you? Because this is a situation that's just completely avoidable. This isn't a policy that we have to implement. Now, that's not saying Obama was good on the issue of immigration. We know, in fact, he wasn't. He was pretty far right on the issue. But it's also true that while the Obama administration put unaccompanied minors, so kids coming to the border and they don't have any adults with them, they put them in these, like, detention centers, so like child jails. This policy apparently just started a few months ago of when a family comes across the border, you separate the family, and the way in which they take the kids away was also really disturbing. They would tell the mothers, like, oh, we're just going to take your kid to go have a bath, and then they just don't bring them back. And with the zero tolerance policy, what that means is everybody who crosses the border gets criminally prosecuted. And, you know, the kids are separated from them almost immediately when they cross the border. And then they go to these tender age detention centers, as they call them. Really, as others have pointed out, it's basically a child jail, a child prison. So this led to a gigantic outcry and a sustained outcry. And this is one of those issues where, you know, the mainstream media really ran with this story. And it's a rare instance of me saying, okay, I get it why you would run with this story. Usually mainstream media outrage is saved for stuff like Russiagate and Stormy Daniels and stuff that I don't necessarily think there's as big of a story there as they're making it out to be. But this is an instance where I think it makes sense to cover this in a sustained way where you're outraged by it. I get that there is a decent amount of hypocrisy where the mainstream media really didn't seem to care about the abuses with the way we handle immigration under the Obama administration. Trump has ticked that up ever so slightly, and as a result of ticking it up, it has led to a backlash. And you know what? I'll take it. Admittedly, the media is somewhat hypocritical in the fact that they didn't care much under Obama when, for his abuses. But, hey, if we're at the right position now, which is outrage over a policy that shouldn't exist, I'll take it. And guess what? As a direct result of that sustained media outcry, but also as a direct result of genuine activism sparked by, you know, this audio and other images and whatnot, Trump caved to an extent. So what he did is... he signed an executive order. By the way, hours after he said, I can't sign an executive order to change this, he ended up signing an executive order to change it. And he says it's still a zero tolerance policy, but they're going to keep the families together, I guess, for a longer period of time or something like that. Listen, in my mind, it just shouldn't be a zero tolerance policy. I mean, we covered this story the last show we did, and I said I would honestly rather have, I actually think it's more humane, if somebody crosses the border illegally and they're with their family, I would think it's more humane to literally keep them together but deport them. Now, I get that there's, you know, a question of asylum, and of course you should vet each individual case to see if they have a genuine case of asylum where they should be able to stay. But I would rather have that than split up the families and criminally prosecute everybody initially crossing the border, because that's a apart from being inhumane, that's also just a gigantic waste of resources. I mean, criminally prosecuting people who just crossed the border, that doesn't strike me as like, oh, what an egregious crime that deserves everybody to get the book thrown at them. I just don't think it's that serious. I mean, first of all, most of the people who are crossing the border are people who are just trying to create a better life for themselves and their families. So understanding that reality, and that it's not like it's nothing but hordes of MS-13 crossing the border, to criminally prosecute everybody, it's unethical, it's immoral, and it's a stupid waste of financial resources. I mean, it just shouldn't be used in that way. So he backed away from the harshest portion of this, which is the family separation virtually immediately when they cross the border. But they still have the zero tolerance policy of prosecuting people. And apparently the roughly 3,000 kids who were already separated from their families, apparently part of this executive order is not reunification for those families. So if you're already separated, you're fucked. You're fucked. But if you're not already separated, okay, we're not going to separate you further. But we're still going to have a zero-tolerance policy and prosecute everybody criminally who crosses the border. I don't think that's enough, you know? But I also think that, you know, the outrage usually is a little misguided in the sense that when you get this outrage, and it's better than no outrage, don't get me wrong, very rarely do you get outrage, but then also like, and here is our comprehensive solution to and how we should actually be handling this. Basically, the outcry was, I can't believe you're doing the family separation. And then the response from the Trump administration was, okay, we'll stop doing the family separation. We'll keep every other shitty aspect of this policy in place, but we'll stop doing the family separation. Okay, well then, yeah, the initial response immediately after that has to be, okay, that's a good first step, but don't do a zero-tolerance policy where you criminally prosecute everybody who crosses the border. So, and they have no intention of stopping that. So, I don't know, it's good that the family separation stopped. Like I said, I'd rather have a situation where, yes, you vet each case for, hey, do they deserve asylum or not, but I would honestly rather have even keeping the family together but deportation than breaking up the family and criminally prosecuting. So I guess it's a step in the right direction to not do that splitting up of the families, but I honestly would go further and just stop criminally prosecuting people, everybody who crosses the border. Listen, I've said it before, I consider myself somewhat moderate on the issue of immigration in the sense that I think deporting violent criminals, I have no problem with that whatsoever, none at all. The problem to me becomes, if you're deporting people who aren't violent criminals, particularly people who've been here for an extended period of time and they're just productive members of society, and also the rampant fear-mongering and scaremongering over immigrants as if they're like the cause of everybody's problems. Meanwhile, when you look at the crime rate of immigrants, both documented immigrants and undocumented immigrants, it's actually lower than native citizens. So, you know, it's basically, it's fear-mongering, and it's scapegoating, and it's a way to try to get people to not blame the elite for their problems, and the fact that our government is corrupt and rigged in favor of Wall Street and the rich, the billionaires. It's a way to try to say, no, don't look over here, look over there. It's got to be those much poorer brown people who are the problem. And then, of course, you can't have a conversation about immigration without bringing up the elephant in the room, which is the real cause of all these problems, it's the drug war. Because the drug war makes it so that a lot of these countries where they're coming from, Guatemala, El Salvador, you name it, they're absolutely obliterated, decimated by the drug war. And did you know, Guatemala or El Salvador, one of those countries had a worse violence rate than Iraq during the height of the Iraq war. I mean, think about that. That means that a lot of the people who are coming over are genuinely seeking asylum. So, I mean, the way you get to the root of the issue to try to fix it is to stop the drug war. If you stop the drug war, you can basically obliterate the cartels over a short period of time, and then the crime rate drops massively, and the drug gangs all but disappear because it's no longer profitable to be in a drug gang because they're not reaping all the profits of the illegal drugs that are sold on the black market. So if you had a policy of legalize taxing and regulating drugs, I mean, that would solve so many of these problems. I mean, it really would. But of course, what you have is the worst of both worlds from this Republican administration, where they ramp up the drug war, so that makes the problem even worse, and then they act even more inhumanely when people cross the border. So it's just, it's not good. It's not good. And it is a messy situation. It is a complex situation. I'm not in the crowd of people on the left who think that any and all conversations about border security are inherently oppressive or racist or anything like that. I'm generally a fan of a welfare state, and as many political scientists have pointed out, in order to have a welfare state, you do need to have some border controls. So I'm not in the group that's like totally anti-border in favor of open borders and things like that. But I do think that the way we handle it now is way too far right wing, way too inhumane. And to stop splitting up the families is a start. But really, I mean, one of the most important things is you should stop criminally prosecuting everybody who crosses the border. I mean, that would that's like a duh thing in my mind. And really, you should only deport people who are violent criminals. At least that's my standard on it. It's good that they took a step in the right direction, which shows, by the way, that a political outcry works. That's another lesson to take away from this. Sustained media opposition, sustained leftist opposition on the ground, where there were planned protests in all these different cities, and the head of Department of Homeland Security was chased out of a restaurant because of what's going on in the news. It was Democratic Socialists basically jeered her out of the restaurant. This sustained outrage really moved the needle and moved it quickly, where even Trump was like, okay, all right, we'll back off the worst aspects of it. So that shows you people do have more power than we feel like we do oftentimes. So it's just a matter of what is the actual solution in the long run. And I would say you have to end the drug war. That would get to the root of the problem and really address the root of the problem. And then, yes, you do have to have a system that's more humane in dealing with people who cross the border. Not 100% prosecution, not breaking up the families. And I don't know, it's good at least to see that finally on something there was a little movement in the right direction.